Lord, we pray that you would speak to us through this description of these ancient events. Please show us what this has to do with us, and please equip us to live wholeheartedly for you this week. For we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've ever played cricket or watched cricket, you should know batting isn't all that complicated. It's just difficult. All you actually have to do is keep your eye on the ball. If you keep your eye on the ball, you'll hit it. When you're batting, though, the challenge is to try to do that one simple thing, keep your eye on the ball over and over again, whilst trying to cope with pace, bounce, movement, the fielders, tiredness, and perhaps even a little bit of sledging in your ear as well. But it's not complicated. It's just difficult. And it's like that with living as a Christian. Living for the Lord Jesus Christ isn't really complicated. It's just hard. See, living as a Christian is basically about trusting God. It's about believing God when he speaks. And the challenge is to do that same thing over and over again, listening to what God says, whilst trying to cope with our selfishness and insecurity and pride and idolatry and unbelief. Living as a Christian is trying to do this one simple thing, trusting God, in the middle of tricky relationships, a broken society, and a flawed world. It's not all that complicated. It's just difficult. And that's why there is a real sense in which God's work in our lives is focused on this one thing. See, this is the basic thing that God does in us and for us. He works to make it possible for people like you and me to trust him. God speaks to us by his Spirit through the Bible to enable us to trust him. God pours his Spirit into our lives, joining us to Christ so that we're able to trust him. God gradually changes us, transforming the way we think and feel so that we will trust him. God's work in our lives is focused on this one simple thing, making it possible for people like you and me to trust him. And Genesis 15 is all about this one thing. It is all about God working in Abraham to enable Abraham to trust him. Now, most of the chapter's taken up with an amazing conversation between God and Abraham, but it opens with a stunning announcement. You'll see it in verse 1, right at the start of our reading on page 13. After this, the word of the Lord, or Yahweh, came to Abraham in a vision. Do not be afraid. I am your shield. I am your very great reward. God speaks to Abram. The word vision here always refers to a message with specific kind of verbal content rather than just seeing pictures. And he says three simple things. Don't be afraid. Abram had very good reason to be afraid. In chapter 14, if you were here last week, you may remember he pulled off a daring commando raid with just 318 men to rescue his nephew Lot and his family. However, in doing so, he had annoyed the five most powerful kings in the area, especially a guy called Kedar Laomer, the neighborhood political bully. He had good reason to be afraid. And he also had some history in the fear department. Back in chapter 12, he'd persuaded Sarah to go into Pharaoh's harem because he was afraid that Pharaoh might kill him. Abram, like the rest of us, was clearly capable of cowardice. So what does God say to him? God says tenderly, don't be afraid. Then Yahweh announces, I am your shield. That too would have been deeply reassuring. Even if the local coalition, these five kings, come looking for him, God himself has guaranteed Abram's security. Even if he finds himself again in a situation where other men fancy Sarah, his wife, and plot to get rid of him, God will protect him. God says, Abram, I am your shield. And then God says, I am your very great reward. Now that really is remarkable. God says to Abraham, I will give you myself. And your prize is, it's me. Now we may not have seen that coming, because yes, God has promised Abraham to give him a new land and descendants and a key role in his master plan to reach the world. But this is new. Now God says, I will give you myself. See, according to Genesis 15, verse 1, the God of the Bible is anti-fear, and he provides both security and satisfaction. And that simple statement is repeated and amplified all the way through the Bible to the coming of the Lord Jesus. And then it's blasted out for everyone to hear in the gospel. So that means that these words that God speaks to Abraham, he has spoken louder and clearer to us in the Lord Jesus. See, our God is in the business of eradicating fear through the gospel of Jesus. For as the Apostle John says, there's no fear in love. Perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. John's talking about Jesus' death on the cross. Jesus takes our punishment. Jesus faces God's wrath. So there is no need to be afraid. And our God is the ultimate expert in security. In fact, God alone can guarantee our long-term security. When we're brought to new life by God through the Spirit using the gospel, when we become Christians, if we make that step, then we could not possibly be more secure. As Paul says in Romans 8, "For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." I don't think it gets any more secure than that. And our God satisfies us by giving himself to us through the gospel. Jesus himself, the night before he died, prayed this. He said, "This is eternal life, Father, real life that starts now and lasts forever. This is life that they," that's us, "know you, the only true God in Jesus Christ whom you've sent." The greatest thing that life has to offer is knowing God himself. The American John Piper writes this, "The critical question for our generation and every generation is this. If you could have heaven with no sickness, all the friends you ever had on earth, and all the food you ever liked, and all the leisure activities you ever enjoyed, and all the natural beauties you ever saw, all the physical pleasures you ever tasted, and no human conflict and natural disasters, could you be satisfied? Could you be satisfied with heaven if Christ were not there?" Piper goes on. You see, the gospel is not a way to get people to heaven. It's a way to get people to God. Because God is our satisfaction. Nothing and no one else will do the job. See, our God is committed to dealing with our fear and providing security and giving us real, lasting, limitless satisfaction. That was true for Abraham, and it's true for us. This is what God offers us in the Lord Jesus Christ through the gospel. The big question is, do we actually believe him? Do we trust God when he says all this? Do we actually think that God can deliver? Or to put it slightly differently, honestly, as we sit here this morning, do we really believe God? Do we believe that God is enough for you and me? See, it is a stunning announcement that God says, "I'll deal with fear. You can be secure and satisfied in me, but only in me." So how do we react? Are we delighted and freed and strengthened when we hear God make that statement? Or are we silently going, "Really?" We know what our answer should be, but sometimes it doesn't work like that. Sometimes people like us need to be persuaded, convinced to trust God, to take what he says at face value and believe it. And in the amazing conversation that takes up most of this chapter, God himself goes to great lengths to get Abraham to trust him, which I think is hugely reassuring for people like us. I don't know about you. I don't know many famous people. I'm not really famous. In fact, I think I only know one. The Edge, the guitarist from U2. And this week I watched as The Edge and the rest of U2 gave their new album away for free to 500 million people instantly at the touch of a button at the launch of the new iPhone. I was watching them on the screen. It's a very strange experience. The last time I talked to him was in our church back in Dublin, Christmas Eve before we left. And the time before that, we sat and had a mug of tea together in his mum and dad's living room. It's a bit weird seeing a guy that you know on the screen being beamed worldwide. But a few short conversations with an aging rock star doesn't really compare with the kind of conversation Abraham has with the living God. It's not his first conversation, and it won't be his last. But just let this sink in. This man, Abraham, has a real mind-blowing back-and-forward conversation with the living God. Now, it's hard to miss. Just look at how many times we're either told that God speaks or Abraham speaks in this chapter, and that's quite deliberate. It's in verse 1, the word of the Lord came to Abraham. Verse 2, but Abraham said. Verse 4, the word of the Lord came. Verse 5, God took him outside and said. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Verse 7, he also said to him. Verse 8, but Abraham said. Verse 9, the Lord said. Verse 13, the Lord said again. And verse 18, on that day he made a covenant with Abraham and said. This is a conversation. And it's one of the most amazing conversations that has ever taken place. And what are they talking about? They're talking about trust. Yahweh is giving Abraham every reason to believe what he says. Now, God does three simple things in the rest of Genesis 15. He repeats his earlier promises. He reassures Abraham that he can deliver. And he guarantees that he will do what he's promised. First, in 15 verse 2, Abram raises the fact that even though God has promised him countless descendants, he and Sarah haven't actually managed to produce one yet. And as he's 80, and Sarah is well beyond the menopause, this is becoming a bit of an issue. So what does God do when Abram raises this? He doesn't correct him or punish him. Instead, he graciously repeats his promise in verses 4 and 5. This time specifically telling him he's going to have a son, and that his descendants will be like the stars in the sky. Then in 15 verse 7, Yahweh reassures Abram. He takes him back to the events described at the end of chapter 11. He said, look, Abram, do you remember, I am Yahweh who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans way back home in Babylonia to give you this land to take possession of it. God effectively says, I didn't bring you this far to let things fall apart now. God reassures Abram that he can and will deliver on his promise and give Abram the land in which he's living. Now, again, this promise wasn't easy for Abram to believe. There were at least 10 nations already living there beside him. So Abram says, okay, how are you going to do this? And this time, God gives Abram a concrete guarantee that he will do what he promises. That's what's going on in verses 9 to 20. God gives Abram a guarantee to help him trust him. In the ancient Near East, if a king wanted to give one of his loyal subjects a piece of land as a reward for being a generally good bloke or repelling invaders or something like that, he set up a thing called a land grant covenant. So instead of exchanging contracts and transferring money like we do, the parties would cut some animals in half and set them out in two rows, and they'd walk between them, with the understanding being, either party reneged on the deal, then, well, that's what they could expect to happen to them. They'd get sliced up and put in two piles, okay? Now, that's really what's going on in verses 9 to 10. Everything is set up for a covenant to be ratified or confirmed. Normally, each party would agree the closing date, and at a specified time, they would show up and sort of sign the contract by literally walking between the sacrifices. But that's not exactly what happens. See, this covenant seems to be a bit one-sided. Just look with me at verse 17. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants I give this land from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river. Abraham doesn't walk through the sacrifices, only God does. In this covenant, it isn't that God makes a commitment and Abram makes a commitment, and if either of them fail to deliver, then the deal is off. This one's different. It's kind of lopsided. The whole ritual is aimed to guarantee to Abraham that God will do what he promised, namely give Abram the land. See, Abram in this chapter is not finding it easy to trust God. What does God do? He gently repeats the promise. He tenderly reassures Abram that he will keep it. And then he sets up a vivid ritual, a dramatic legal process to give Abram a guarantee that God will come through on his promises. Isn't it beautiful the way that God bends over backwards to help Abram believe his promise? Yahweh basically does everything to persuade and convince and reassure Abraham. That's the way the covenant of Genesis 15 works. But then in the Bible, these covenant things are always like that. See, our God goes to enormous lengths to woo us and persuade us and nurture us and cheer us on. Our God is a God who says, I'll be your God, you'll be my people. But he keeps both sides of the bargain. He makes it possible for us to keep ours. That's the way covenants work. Yahweh is always the one who does the real work. It's true for Abraham, and it's true for everyone who belongs to the Lord Jesus Christ. See, biblical Christianity always recognizes the fact that God is the one who does the real work. That our God brings us to life in Christ and forgives us in Christ and changes us and purifies us and declares us not guilty in Christ and gives us the strength to keep going and brings us home in Christ. It's God who rescues us. It's God who does all that. And I really hope we've got that. It isn't 100% us. It's not 50% us and 50% God. It isn't even 99% God and 1% us. We are rescued by grace alone through Christ. That means it's 100% down to God. That's why ultimately we can sleep at night safe in the knowledge that God won't let us go. Because our God is utterly reliable, a promise-making, promise-keeping God who gently repeats his commitment to us and reassures us of his promises and is guaranteed that he will keep his promises to us in the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. But what about Abram's part in all this? Does he have to do anything at all? Do we? Well, it is true that he cuts up some animals in verse 10. He scares off a few vultures in verse 11. And he does fall asleep quite impressively in verse 12. But apart from that, what does he do? Well, not all that much. See, when it comes to making covenants, Yahweh does all the real work. But Abram does something hugely significant in this chapter. And I think it takes us right to the heart of what God has to teach us through Genesis 15. In verse 6, we're told that Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord credited it to him as righteousness. The word believe here means trust. We could translate it, Abram put his full weight on God. Abram trusted what God had said to him. He believed God's promises would come true. Now, of course, that is a good thing. But let me ask you a question. Should Abram get any credit for this? If I said to you that Phil Campbell had told me something really quite shocking and that I believed them, I hope that wouldn't raise too many eyebrows. Over the years, Phil has proven himself to be a trustworthy guy who doesn't make things up or make slanderous accusations. You wouldn't say, wow, that's so good of Gary to believe Phil. Because Phil's trustworthy. Well, I hope you think he's trustworthy, you know? But if that's true of Phil, how much more true is it of God? See, trusting God should be a real no-brainer. God is the God who keeps his promises. He is absolutely and utterly truthful and dependable. Abram shouldn't have got any credit for that. That's just common sense. But incredibly, Abram did get credit for it. God stamped righteous beside his name. Because he trusts God, because he takes God at his word, because he believes God, God counts Abram as one of his people. Credit here is an accounting word. Abram's name gets written in the column reserved for people who are right with God. Just for believing the God who always tells the truth. Abram gets a relationship with God that will last forever. And that's always how it is with God. He does all the real work. He speaks the truth. And people like Abram and you and me just have to believe what God says to trust him that he'll come through in his promises. And without us actually doing anything of any real significance, we get to be part of God's people forever. Seems ridiculous. But it is. It's true. This is how God worked for Abram. This is how it works for us. It's all about trusting what God says. God made promises. Abram believed. God stamped righteous beside his name. Jesus Christ came and said, Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but is crossed over from death to life. See, the key issue for us is not whether or not we believe God's promises to Abraham, but whether or not we trust Jesus, the one who came and lived and died and rose again and rules for us. The one who says to us, trust me and I will give you eternal life. And that's what happens when we say, yes, Jesus, you speak the truth. God stamps righteous beside our name too. We get a relationship with God that lasts forever, not because we deserve it or have done anything impressive, but simply because we've trusted the trustworthy God to do what he says. God does the real work. In fact, the Bible actually says that even the ability to trust God is a gift from him. We can't do it on our own. We can't take credit for it. And yet God gives us credit. Imagine a teenager doing a school project. It has to be, say, a three-dimensional model of, say, a plant cell, okay? This is purely fictional, obviously. One parent gets the box, which will provide the frame. The other parent goes and buys the plasticine. The first parent finds a model of a plant cell online, looking remarkably like the picture. The second parent prints out the labels on the stickers and finds some cocktail sticks. The first parent rescues the teenager's first attempt to make the model before she went off to watch TV. The second parent gets her back from the TV to stick in the labels. The first parent puts the model carefully in the boot of the car and drives both the model and the teenager to school on the right day. At the end of school, the teenager comes home and proudly announces, I'm so pleased with myself, I got an A for my project. You get the picture. God enabled Abram to trust. Abram trusted God, and God credited to him as righteousness. See, if we trust God, not only is it because God himself enabled us to do it, but God has included us in his family and will never remove us because we're forgiven and set free to live with him. What a generous God we have. We stand back for a second and look at how this chapter unfolds. It's really striking the lengths that God goes to in order to reassure and strengthen and support Abraham. He said, don't be afraid. I'm your shield. I'm your reward. Then he gently reminds him that he will fulfill his promises. He assures him that nothing will deflect him from that. And then he gives him this striking, compelling visual aid, an enacted guarantee to prove to Abraham that he would come through on his promises. And God does all this so that Abraham would believe what he has said. He does all this to stir up Abram's trust in him. He does it to strengthen his faith. Our God does go to enormous lengths to produce and sustain our trust in him. Why does God speak to us day by day, week by week, about Christ by the Spirit through the Bible? To stir up trust. Why does our God give us guarantees, visual aids, signs of a new covenant, if you prefer, like baptism and the Lord's Supper, which we're about to share? He does it to stir up our trust in what he has said. When Jesus took bread and wine and said, this is the new covenant in my blood, do this to remember me, he gave us a sign which is both simple and profound. It's not magic, but it is powerful because it reminds us that the Lord Jesus Christ can be trusted. It reassures us that he can be trusted. It is a guarantee that he will come through on his commitment to us, helping us to keep going to the end and taking us to live with him forever in the new creation. So it equips us to live for him in the strength that he provides. So this morning, as we celebrate this new covenant, our covenant, as we delight in Christ and all that he has done for us, let's eat and drink and look to him again for our security and our satisfaction. As we hear Christ say to us, don't be afraid. I am your shield. I am your very great reward. And then in his strength, let's do something which is not complicated, but is difficult. Let's trust in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.